Please mind the gap between the train and the platform.
For there is in London all that life can afford.
Highgate Cemetery, a burial ground to many famous pioneers, scientists, and important activists, holds over 170,000 corpses buried in 53,000 graves. But this scenic cemetery holds the secrets of one of London's greatest mysteries. Years and years ago, on this very ground, strange sightings and dramatic duels between vampire hunters took place. This is the story of the vampire of Highgate Cemetery. Highgate was built in 1839 as one of the few cemeteries built to help deal with the unruly number of dead bodies piling up. It was built as one of seven cemeteries that were located all around London, Highgate being a favourite amongst Victorian society. According to some sources, there had been a few strange paranormal sightings surrounding Highgate, stretching back over 300 years. None held a flame to the countless sightings of the vampire of Highgate Cemetery. The strange figure was often described as having glowing red eyes and a tall, lean figure. Sometimes visitors would report an uneasy feeling of being watched as they walked the grounds. During the time of these sightings, the cemetery had fallen into serious disarray. The Second World War had just ended and vines grew thick over graves, with the wildlife overall just becoming increasingly hard to manage. During this time, many horror movies shot scenes in Highgate, some of these films including From Beyond the Grave and Taste the Blood of Dracula. As sightings began to build up and local newspapers reported on the strange happenings, David Farrant, a supernatural enthusiast, began to take a keen interest in the topic. At the same time, however, a second man, Sean Manchester, another occult enthusiast, also began to take an interest in the topic, with both giving interviews to newspapers. Many people actually continued to flock to the cemetery in an attempt to witness Manchester and Farron actually rid the cemetery of its vampire. In a bizarre turn of events, the two actually decided to host a duel to find out once and for all who was the better magician. Advertisements for said duel began to appear all over London, scheduled for the 13th of April 1973. Rumours began to fly around the media claiming that the two were planning to sacrifice a cat, and when a local man's pet failed to return home, Farron was demonised by the RSPCA for allegedly having beheaded the pet in a pagan cultist ritual. To this day, the feud between the two has never really died, both believing themselves to be superior to the other. Walking through the graveyard, I don't feel as though I'm being watched, but rather intrigued by the rich history. I found myself mesmerised by the cracks in the gravestones, imagining the lives of those who have lived before me. But who knows? Perhaps there's a reason the cemetery closes so early.
Think about it. Have you ever seen me take a nap? I'm guessing not. You're so used to walking on me, you've never actually thought anything of it. You see me on a daily basis, but did you ever think I would be taking naps for 8 minutes every 12 hours? Yes, you heard correctly, 8 minutes. The majority of other insects also demonstrate some form of sleep or resting behaviour. For example, fruit flies sleep very similar to humans. They can sleep up to 7 hours a night. So there we go, ants power nap and fruit flies sleep like humans. Thank you for watching.
Loss, one of the things in life we all go through. And pain, we all feel it. But how do you deal with the pain of loss?
Can't you hear me? I'm not coming home. Do you understand?
Loss to me is a feeling of a missing presence and the feeling that something isn't right. However many times I go through loss, it never gets easier. And the hardest thing about it is the impact that it leaves with me and my family. Anytime I see family or friends distraught or depressed, it just puts me in a very bad place, and my mental state is never the best when I go through loss.
What does loss mean to you?
Loss means to me the feeling of feeling something is missing and the feeling of sadness.
Loss to me is losing someone or something special.
Losing a connection with someone that you had before.
Have you ever experienced loss?
Yeah, I've experienced loss twice.
No, I haven't experienced loss, but judging from what I've heard, it's one of the most painful feelings ever, and I hope not to feel that.
Yeah, I've experienced loss at the age of 9 when my grandfather passed away.
How do you cope with loss?
Just spend more time with family and distract myself by going to sports.
I just try to spend more time with family and try to uplift my mood and everyone else's around.
Is there a specific way your culture handles loss?
Yes, in my culture we handle loss by celebrating and parading a person's life rather than anguishing in the fact that they've been lost.
In my culture, on the 14th day of the person's death, we gather around with our family, cook food, and it's just basically some sort of like remembrance. We check up on the family, if everyone's doing okay, if they need anything, and yeah.
After hearing about what the three individuals had to say about what loss means to them and how their culture deals with loss, I've got a better insight on cultural differences. Ghanaian people celebrate, parade, and appreciate the time they had with the lost person. Turkish and Kurdish people get together with the family 40 days after the person has deceased and cook and eat food to pay their respects. When somebody passes away in my culture, my parents and other families will go to the house of the family of the deceased person and show their respects by taking gifts. We call this yasir. In the Islamic faith, the body has to get buried as quick as possible. The body has to be washed and covered with a sheet by family members. The hands are placed as if in a prayer, then the body is transported to the funeral location, which is a mosque.
The only thing guaranteed in life is death. Appreciate your time with your loved ones and cherish every moment you have with them, as it can all go as quickly as it came.
Listen, I just don't think it's gonna work out. No, we don't need to talk about this. You're just too late.
Yesterday you started the conversation. Said, how are you? Said, I'm better now that you said hello. And I got lost in your eyes, hid behind my smile, as if it was my disguise. And I jumped at the right time. Never been the one to fall in love so up my glasses. You say that I'm overreacting, baby. Can't you see that I'm madly crazy, truly in love with you? It's true. Oh, I'm in love with you.
Did you know anything about racial diversity in the fashion industry? For an industry built on intricate artistic visions, there is a weak and stop-start attitude towards race. Although shocking, these incidents follow ingrained industry patterns, including the use of blackface, whitewashing, and cultural appropriation. There are many examples of cultural appropriation. Designers can be found using aspects of different cultures inappropriately. In most cases, taking traditional clothing from Middle Eastern, African, and Hispanic culture and adding into the runaway shows, causing a lot of backlash. After years of jaw-on-the-floor moments of racial insensitivity, there's been a lot of backpedal. The move to right these wrongs has included getting more models of color to appear in shows. So, did you know about this?
Thank you. The world is gonna roll me.
I was drawn to the elegance and sophistication of dark academia, and the history, the relation to Greek mythology. It can sound a bit pretentious at times, but that's just what makes it a bit fun as well. To me, dark academia is an appreciation for literature, writing, learning, and when it comes to clothes and aesthetics, it can be expressed through like tweed or blouses or dark brown or dark clothes.
When I think of vintage, I think of it as an aesthetic that evokes different time periods. It's like 15 different items that were once valued in the past. They could be clothes, records, music, or accessories. To me, it is an appreciation of the past and how much we have evolved.
It idolizes the idea of living a simple life in a cute cottage. Typical cottagecore clothing is anything like summery dresses, light blouses, and anything floral. The thing that made this particular aesthetic pleasing to me is the escapism aspect of it. It reminds me of summer and the countryside. I also really like the color palette that comes with the cottagecore aesthetic. It consists of mostly pale / muted green, yellow, warm, white, and vintage style floral prints.
There's a need for exposure for young artists of color and young queer artists and other marginalized people. So we were just thinking, why don't we make the platform to launch other people's art and get other people recognized? So that's kind of where the collective was born. It's important that it's called Art Host because we want to define how we're being seen. So we get to choose our narrative, we get to represent ourselves.
Well, to Markham, Ontario now, where police say the suspicious deaths of four people found
underway after
yesterday.
The murder of an 18-year-old college
there
freshman.
There are fears that a serial killer is on the loose in Tampa, Florida. Police
massive manhunt for a suspected serial killer on the loose in Florida.
And on the floor, we like to take back roads. We just went down that road, and there was a guy standing on the road.
Didn't do anything.
Hey guys, today we will be learning about different interesting facts about pandas. Did you know a baby panda is smaller than a mouse at birth? This is because giant pandas subsist entirely on bamboos, which have a very low nutrition value. They are about 3.5 ounces, which is like 100 grams and about 4 inches. Since they are so miniature at birth, giant panda parents can accidentally crush or kill their babies. Giant pandas almost always abandon a cub if they give birth to more than one. The reason is that they don't have sufficient milk or energy to care for two, so they focus their attentions on the strongest cub. In 2012, Washington, Mei Xiang gave birth to a cub, which died after 6 days from liver and lung problems. We have another case where in Tokyo, a 6-year-old cub died from pneumonia after its mother's milk got in its airway. Officials said that 60 to 70% of newborn pandas die within their first week. This is also why there are barely any pandas left, because giant pandas always accidentally crush their babies. Pandas are endangered and they rarely reproduce. This can cause the panda species to go extinct. There are panda breeding centers so that they avoid this loss. Now, do you know why a baby panda is smaller than a mouse? Share this small fact with your friends and family, adding the new information to their general knowledge.
Gandhi till I'm charged and writing in my book of rhymes all the words past the sweat off my dome, spit the phlegm on the streets. Sway Tim's on my beats, makes my cypher complete. Weather cruising in a six cab, I'm on tarot deep, I can't call it. The beats make me falling asleep, I keep falling. But never falling 6 feet deep, I'm out for presidents to represent me. Say what? I'm out for.
Did you know the internet is racist? Okay, I want you to list some of the most famous YouTubers you can think of in your head. Notice how you didn't say anyone black. It's okay, it's not your fault. Majority of the top YouTubers are not black. But why is that? Now look at this. Top beauty channels. Top gaming channels. Top lifestyle channels. Top family channels. Notice a pattern? Also, why have racists become some of the most famous YouTubers? Using slurs?
A young n got a bag cause I'm brown.
Doing blackface?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
No.
Doing negative stereotypes?
Rup, 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 roll up to the party with my crazy pink wig. But I can't get through the door because my booty's too big.
And just being flat out racist towards black people. I do understand that people can make an ignorant mistake at a young age. But a white creator will make the mistake of being racist but will continue to grow their following and thrive with no repercussions. However, a black content creator may make a much smaller and generally accidental mistake, and it will completely stain their career. Why isn't everyone being held at the same standard? Why is there such inequality? This way, racists will continue to thrive, while black people have to work 10 times harder just to be noticed. Did you know the internet is racist?
What does time mean to you? In this world, time keeps the earth ticking.
Without it, how would we control and organize everything? But time to some people may mean different things. To me, time means two different things. The first being using time to achieve certain goals in life because we're not here forever and we've got to make the most of the time we're given. And the second meaning of time, to me, is how time keeps the world in order and keeps everyone in check. There was a quote I read by a man called William Penn. He said, "Time is what we want the most, but what we use the worst." If you go deeper into this, it's true. We always want more time, but what we do with that time is important. There was another quote from a book written by Mark Levy, and he said, "If you want to know the value of 1 year, just ask a student who failed a course. If you want to know the value of 1 month, ask a mother who gave birth to a premature baby. If you want to know the value of 1 hour, ask the lovers waiting to meet. If you want to know the value of 1 minute, ask the person who just missed the bus. If you want to know the value of 1 second, ask the person who just escaped death in a car accident. And if you want to know the value of 1/100th of a second, ask the athlete who won a silver medal in the Olympics." When you think about it, time isn't real. Time is just a concept made by us humans. How do you know that the time right now is the real time?
Did you know that Shakespeare invented over 1,700 words? Shakespeare used more than 20,000 words in his poems and plays.
Which of these three words do you think Shakespeare invented? Dishearten, mullock, or crusade?
Is it the first one, sorry?
Yes, you're correct. It was dishearten, and it was used in Henry V. Which of these three words do you think Shakespeare invented? Fashionable, lansperis edo, or thrice?
Fashionable sounds like a new word, like from now, so is it thrice?
You're incorrect. It was actually fashionable and was used in Troilus and Cressida.
On the 14th of June 1969, six-year-old Dennis Martins was playing an innocent game of hide-and-seek with friends and family in a nature resort. Little did anyone know, Dennis would never be found. At the same time as this hide-and-seek game was going on, the Key family was spotting wildlife nearby. They had spotted what, at first, they had thought was a bear, but upon closer inspection, it had been a strange figure carrying a young boy over his back. The Martins family had been unaware of the disappearances of 12 young boys around the same area at the same time. To this day, all 12 of these cases remain unsolved. The FBI agent who was assigned to Dennis's case tragically killed himself not too long after Dennis went missing. Many people speculate that this FBI agent had come across something so traumatic that he wasn't able to handle it and ended his own life. In current day, the police force is no closer to solving the case than they were all these years ago. And as the days pass by, the case becomes less and less likely to be solved.
Somebody get me a hammer. Wanna break all the clocks in the mirror. Back to a time that was different, a time when I didn't feel like there was something missing. Now my body and mind are so distant, don't know how.
Listen.
One shot, one opportunity, to seize everything you ever wanted, one moment, did you capture, just let it slip, yo. His palms are sweaty, knees weak, arms are heavy, there's vomit on his sweater already, mom's spaghetti, he's nervous, but on the surface he looks calm and ready to drop bombs. But he keeps on forgetting what he wrote down. The whole crowd goes so loud. He opens his mouth, but the words won't come out. He's choking how? Everybody's choking now. The clock's run out. Time's up, over, loud. Snap back to reality. Oh, there goes gravity. Oh, there goes gravity. Choke. He's so mad, but he won't give up. Daddies, he know he won't have it. He knows his whole back to these ropes. It don't matter. He's dope. He knows that, but he's broke. He's so stagnant. He knows when he goes.
Listen, man, get over yourself. This sport ain't no joke. You're sitting there sulking, but put 100% in, or you're gonna get hurt.
What do you think I've been trying to do?
Listen, I know you've been training, but if you're missing training, you seem half-hearted, it's just not good enough.
I put hours in the gym in every day.
So does everyone else. Do you want to be as good as everyone else, or do you want to be better?
Obviously better.
And then act like it. What more are you doing? You know, if you want to be a pro boxer, you've got to be doing extra, not just the limit.
What more can I do? You see me run, you see me train, you see me put everything I can into. What more can I do?
You say you put effort into it, but I'm not seeing that. I'm seeing you hit pads, I'm seeing you do the basics, I'm not seeing you do more.
That's what every boxer does.
Yeah, but every average boxer does that. You want to be more than average, or you want to be the best?
But I want to be the best.
Then act like it. Listen, if you work hard now, you can live the rest of your life as a champ. What's it going to be?
I work hard every day.
You don't. You say you work hard, but you don't. You do the same as everyone else. If you want to be a champ, you got to do more than everyone else. Mate, everyone has two lives.
No, stop. I respect you as a person and as a trainer, but I'm not trying
no,
to
you
hear
stop.
Any of this.
Everyone has two lives. The second one begins when they realise they only have one. This ain't no joke. Boxing ain't no joke. Live life with no regrets. Not everyone can be a boxer.
I can be a boxer.
Be it. Like I said, live your life as if you only have one life. Have no regrets. Achieve your dreams. Listen, mate. I've said everything I need to say on the matter. You've got mad potential. Go out there and do what you gotta do.
I know I can do this. But I thought that's what I've been doing this whole time.
But if you know you can do it, that should be enough motivation to do it. It's all well saying, oh yeah, I'm gonna do that, I'm gonna do this. But you've got to do it.
I'm gonna do it.
Mate, I know you've got this. We'll be right back. Listen, if you work hard now, you can live the rest of your life as a champ. Everyone has two lives. The second one begins when they realize they only have one. What if I told you Earth is due a natural disaster so devastating you would have only witnessed of such things in a film? I can tell you now, I am not joking when I'm talking about the one and only Yellowstone Caldera, also known as the world's most powerful supervolcano. This terrifying life ender is due an eruption, and here is just some of the disasters it can cause. States such as Wyoming, Idaho and Montana would be affected directly by the molten lava. However, the whole of the United States would be impacted by the volcano's falling ash. This monstrous volcano would not only affect the USA, but in fact potentially destroy the whole of the Earth. The eruption would cause gases to rise into the stratosphere, mixing with water vapor and creating sulfur aerosols. This would most likely block or dim out the sun, not allowing crops to grow and plunging the whole of the Earth into winter for years. Even if this wasn't the case, the supervolcano would cause gigantic pillars of ash with the potential of rising up to 100,000 feet. This would also destroy crops and most living organisms. If you mix this in with the almost guaranteed notorious ash clouds, I'd be lying if I said the Earth was in for a treat.
Hello, I'm calling regarding a job offer.
Yes, you must be Mr. Ramos.
Yes, and may I ask what your name is? I don't see it mentioned anywhere on the email.
You can call me Mr. Donny.
Okay, Mr. Donny. As you said in the email, all I have to do is for you to bring items and you'll pay me per item, correct?
Yes, that's correct. Yeah. I'm going to send you a text with all the details for your first job and we'll go from there.
Okay, alright, no problem then. Looking forward to working with you. See you. This guy just paid me up front. Let's get to work. Was quick. What the? Grove Park. That's 2 minutes away. Richard Donny.
What?
That can't be right.
What?
Be caught. Hello, Mr. Donny?
Mr. Donny's dead.
Who's this?
See you soon, Rico Ramos.
Karabakh, a beautiful Caucasian region full of kind and hardworking people, outstanding nature and beautiful culture. But this paradise on earth is ravished by a war. This is Karabakh between the front lines. Tensions are high in the South Caucasus. Armenia and Azerbaijan are waging a war that involves aerial drones, ballistic missiles, special forces, and all other kinds of weaponry. At the heart of the hostilities is Karabakh, a region that is occupied by the Armenian army but is recognized as a part of Azerbaijan. Armenia is claiming that the region has been historically theirs, and since the majority of the population there is Armenian, the land belongs to them. While Azerbaijan is arguing that Karabakh is historically theirs, and the Armenians committed a genocide over the Azerbaijanis in the region, and that they will retake it. To get a better understanding of the current mess, we have to go back to the Soviet Union in the year 1985. This is the year that the Soviet Union, which included both Armenia and Azerbaijan, had a new president, Mikhail Gorbachev. He was different than the previous leaders on a lot of levels. Unlike his predecessors, Konstantin Chernenko, Yuri Andropov, and most notably Leonid Brezhnev, who were known for their era of stagnation, Gorbachev had different ideas. He planned to reform the country by introducing his new policies of perestroika and glasnost. Translated as reforming, the perestroika was a policy of changing the USSR's internal affairs. It was accompanied by glasnost, meaning openness, which allowed criticism over the Politburo's decisions. These two led to the rise of many nationalist sentiments across the country, including in Azerbaijan and Armenia. A striking example of such movements was the 1988 Sumgayit pogrom, when mobs of Azerbaijanis attacked and killed the recently settled Armenian refugees in the Azerbaijani city of Sumgayit. The exact number of the victims is unknown, but different sources claim it's between 32 and 200, and this disturbing tragedy is not the worst to come.
Мы открылись миру. Отказались от вмешательства в чужие дела, от использования войск за пределами страны. И нам ответили доверием, солидарностью и уважением. Мы стали одним из главных оплотов по перестройству современной цивилизации на мирных демократических началах.
These are the words that mark the official dissolution of the Soviet Union. This meant that Azerbaijan and Armenia were now free and independent countries, and all Soviet troops were pulled out of the region. Many people didn't know what was coming next, and they realized that the previous stabilizing power was no longer there to contain the tension. Now, the frozen conflict was more than an internal quarrel, as Gorbachev saw it. The newly established Republic of Armenia realized it has an advantage over the Republic of Azerbaijan, which was in a bigger crisis and took the opportunity. In 1991, the First Karabakh War had officially started. The Armenian army was advancing rapidly. While expanding though, these armed forces committed a series of war crimes. They destroyed civilian homes and forced the survivors to leave everything behind and flee. A group of Azerbaijani refugees was once spotted by the Armenians in the town of Khojaly, in the Karabakh region. The army opened fire on the civilians, killing more than 600 innocents. To this day, the Khojaly massacre remains the biggest tragedy of the whole conflict. This, together with a lot of smaller purges, forced the Azerbaijanis to leave everything they had in Karabakh behind. In Armenia, this was seen as a final victory. In Azerbaijan, it was a temporary loss. For the next near 20 years, the conflict will remain frozen. Europe's longest frozen conflict. A sad story without happy end. Or rather, without any end at all.
Fade in, scene one. The story starts as we follow Tony walking down the road, his shirt ruffled and loose, hidden under a blazer that's a size too small for him. He seems in a rush as the sky slowly turns a bleak grey, as if it was about to burst. Tony feels a buzz in his right pocket and reaches in to grab it. Shuffling through his keys and tangled earphones, he pulls it out and looks at the screen, seeing the words "Mum" flash up. He hesitates for a moment, then answers. Hey Mum, everything okay?
Oh, he lives.
Well, debatable, but yeah.
Yeah, everything's good down here. Just haven't heard from you in a few weeks.
Yeah, sorry, West has been kind of mad this month.
Well, maybe if you visited, you could get a break for a bit. The Lord works in mysterious ways, you know.
I bet he does.
So, how have you been, son?
Yeah, I've been good, you know, getting by.
You don't sound good. What's troubling you?
Tony is quiet, not long enough for his mum to be worried, but long enough to get lost in his thoughts for a moment. He stares across the road as cars zoom past his face, blocking his way across. He doesn't know if he even wants to cross, to go back to his same house, to watch the same TV and go to sleep and just do it all over again the next day. It's draining. He's jolted back to reality from the horn by a car coming by and his mum's voice in his ear.
Tony?
Oh, sorry. No, it's nothing. Just work stuff. He puts on a smile as if to comfort her, even though he knows that she's not there with him. She can feel it through the phone, but more so how fake it is. Aurora sighs. She wants to address it, and she knows she probably should, but she knows her son, and she knows he'll only talk when he's ready. So she changes the subject as Tony continues to walk down the road.
Oh, I almost forgot to say I swung by earlier.
Oh, damn, how come?
Me and Diana, we were going through some of the old boxes that you left in the loft, and we found a bunch of old DVDs that you made.
I was like 15 when I made those.
Yep, I remember. They even have the music videos you did on there. I was going to come and watch them with you, but you didn't answer your damn phone, so...
Ma was at work.
That's no excuse for abandoning your mother. Anyway, I dropped them off in the box and put it by your bin.
Next time, let me know before and I'll come pick them up from yours. I don't exactly live in the best area.
Don't worry, I prayed over it. It's safe. Besides, I feel like you might be needing the motivation.
He laughs as he walks up by his house. He sees the box and leans down to make sure no one's touched it or if it got rained on. He goes to open the door so he can bring it inside. Alright, Ma. I'm home now, so I'll talk to you soon.
Anthony.
This stops him in his tracks. His mum only says that when she's being 100% serious. He lets out a small grunt to let her know that he is listening.
Your dad would have been very proud of you.
He takes a second to compose himself before responding. He wants to say so much, but he doesn't know where he would start or end, so he lets out the only words he can. Love you, Mum. I'll visit soon.
Love you too, son. Talk soon.
He hangs up the phone, looks at the box and sighs. He unlocks his door and sets it down inside before briefly looking up outside at the sky, turning around and kicking the door shut.
Did you know that Jamaica is the world's only flag that does not contain the three colour themes of red, white or blue? And why is this? Since the beginning of flags, they have mostly been from Europe. And in Europe, for some reason, they chose these three colours as a theme to inspire every other flag in the region. And a lot of European countries adopted these colours as a colourful expression of their culture. Now, after colonialism, a lot of the countries that were dominated by European powers, they're forced into these colours. Now in the 50s and 60s, when a lot of countries in Africa started to gain independence from Europe, they adopted into their flag the Pan-Africanist colours, which was black, red, yellow and green. And these colours were taken from the Ethiopian flag, which was one of Africa's only countries to not get colonised by the Europeans. And this culminated into Jamaica's flag, which has strong African roots. They decided to have a flag inspired by the colours of the Pan-Africanist movement. This was a homage to their Pan-African roots. In conclusion, not only is the Jamaican flag one of the nicest looking flags in the world, it's also got an interesting history behind it.
I'm beginning to grasp how fast life is passing by. Faster than I imagined. As the years went by, I started to realize how fast time passes as you do the things you love, as well as how time slows down when you're doing something you don't enjoy doing. time is not always in your favor. The more fun things you do in life, the faster time passes by. We often regret many decisions we make, and we understand that we could use our time better, and then regret we didn't spend it wisely. So we dream of how good it would be to fix things we have done or didn't do long ago. The older we get, the older those memories get as they pass away. I've been obsessed with the fact that no matter what I do, if I enjoy it or I don't, time is always running out, and it terrifies me.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself,
what, do you not remember the good times we had? And you think you could turn your back on me like I'm nothing to you?
David's report contains a distressing account of what
domestic violence is one of Britain's most hidden crimes, with millions of victims enduring horrific treatment behind closed doors. This week, Channel 4 News focused the spotlight on domestic violence with two special reports. Tomorrow, we'll examine controversial new
powers,
which can ban alleged abusers
from their homes
without conviction.
We're going Jason.
We focus on one woman.
I really need to do some work. I'm just getting some work done. And I don't know. I don't think I'm going to come. I just really don't feel like it. All right. I'll get ready now. I'll get my stuff. Okay. I'll see you soon then. Yeah. Bye.
Welcome
the O2 messaging service. The person you are calling is unable to take your call. Please leave your message after the tone. To re-record your message, key hash at any time.
Hello? Hello? I know you can hear me. I know you probably don't want to talk. But you know, I've been thinking, and I'm the one in the wrong, and I have been the one in the wrong. I feel like I fucked up, you know. I ruined what we had. And I know I'm a piece of shit for that, but if there's any way you can think about forgiving me or mending things, or I don't know what, but you know, if you think so, if you think that you can, then give me a call, I guess.
We're sorry, you have reached a number that has been disconnected or is no longer in service.
I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
It was sometime around December, peak corona time. Quarantine and lockdown were still in full effect, and there was nothing to do on Friday and Saturday nights except Zoom call with your friends. It was about a week until I decided to hop on the train. I agreed to hop on a Zoom call with my three friends, Fabian, Mia, and Giselle. It was Friday night, and it was supposed to be our little Zoom chat, just having fun, talking, drinking, and just having a great time. We were just going to be playing drinking games, having fun, chatting, and staying up to the early hours of the morning. Fabian shared the link to join the Zoom chat in our WhatsApp group chat. We joined one at a time. First Fabian, then Mia, and then me. The other two were on their phone, and I was on my laptop, so I decided to switch to my phone. It took a little while for Giselle to join, but when she did, her screen was all fuzzy. Thankfully, we could hear her audio, and she told us that her screen was on, but it wasn't showing on the screen. We all joked around, chanting Giselle's name, and joked about how something bad could be happening to her. Then we began asking her what's up with her webcam. She said that it said her screen was offline, so we tried to help her as best as we could, while continuing to joke around. We tried to be of much assistance, but we couldn't really help her out, so she just decided to tell us, BRB, I'll be right back, I'm gonna go figure this out. So we all just went back onto the call and just chatting and having a good time. She left her device on while we just figured that she'd left the room just to go figure out her problem. Something randomly happened sometime into our call, something completely unexpected, that kind of scarred all of us. Giselle's cam started working, and her box went from a fuzzy screen to an old creepy man doing something I do not want to repeat. When he noticed the camera turn on, he jumped to close the screen. The screen went dark again. The three of us screamed and started freaking out. We tried calling Giselle, but now it seemed her phone was off. We didn't have her mom or sister's number, so we all decided to go over to Alexa's place and check what was going on. Her mom answered the door in her robes, looking concerned. We asked her if Giselle was home. She said yes and called her down. Giselle never responded though. Her mother said that Giselle had gotten home half an hour ago, but her door has only been locked for 20 minutes. Something didn't seem right, especially the timing, so we all explained what happened on the Zoom call. And when she heard what we had to say, she freaked out and ran up the stairs and began banging on her bedroom door. However, that got no answers. We all got a sickly feeling when we realized what could be going on. Giselle's mom began calling the police that very second. And when Officer Morgan showed up, told him everything. He called for backup and went upstairs to knock on the door. And he tried to reason with whoever could be in there. When there was no response, he began to kick the door down. When he finally got the door down, there was no one in the room. The laptop and phone were still on the bed, but it seemed that there was no one here. The window was wide open, so it's likely that whoever was there jumped out the window and ran across the back garden. We all found Giselle in the basement just a few minutes later. She was hiding under a massive duvet blanket in the corner of the room. She said when she was home alone, she saw some older man in her living room with a big knife sticking out of his pocket. So she snuck down to the basement and hid. Didn't know when it was safe to come out of her hiding, as she didn't know when her mother was home. Police backup finally showed up, and the information of the break-in and the man was sent to local news outlets to alert people. It's crazy how that Zoom call might have saved Giselle and her mother's life. A few weeks later, the man was caught, and in the papers it reported that he was actually a convicted serial killer who escaped.
I never told you how much you mean to me. What in the world I would do? I just never made it through to you. Oh, to you. There goes a month, there goes a year. So many things out there I fear. You helped me up when I was down. You taught me how to stand my ground. This life is a song, happy and sad. And I don't wanna sing without you dead. Maybe it's selfish when I say these words, but I'm missing you.
Just calm, man. Don't worry, I'll bring you money in it. Just be cool, man.
Alright. What are you looking at?
Let me have some.
What, haven't you eaten?
No.
Haven't you got any money?
No.
I heard.
Hey, what's your name?
Snatcher.
No, I mean, like, what's your name on your birth certificate?
What?
Turn off, man.
Turn off?
The music, right? Hello, boss.
Ah, I've been expecting you. So, what did you steal from me today?
Yeah, about that. Here's the thing. Well, we actually...
We?
Right, I actually tried to rob a corner shop, but we actually failed. I actually failed. Yeah.
A corner shop? Really? A corner shop?
Yeah, well, we could have, but... Silence.
You are aware that our business is a little, you know, a little illegal.
Hey, what happens if we get caught again?
You got lucky the first time. If you get caught again, then the feds will get involved. The feds get involved.
Feds?
The police, Michael. Feds in slang means police.
Enough. If you don't make me money, I will find you and I will kill you.
Settling, peddling, KP resident. Half of the bros don't gelatin. Run Scooby-Doo, cause we're meddling. The sound for the bots too deafening. Two little horsepower, man. Galloping, rush goalie, cause she bad. Alice.
The money. Can't lie, I made only £2. Well?
What? Well, the money.
Oh yeah, I spent it on this meal deal from Wakefield. I'm not gonna lie, they did all of this for under £3.
Bro, you're not serious. You know he's gonna kill us, right? Listen. I want you to call him up right now and tell him exactly what you did.
You bastard. You mess with my work. I don't appreciate that.
Wait.
Oh. Abdul, where are you going? Oh, help. There's a dying black man on the floor. Oh.
Yeah, man. I don't think I have enough time to complete everything. I just don't have enough energy to do it, man.
Yeah.
I'll call you in a bit, yeah? Say. Yo, you soon.
Yo, where's you? How you doing, man?
Not good, man. I don't have enough energy and time to complete everything.
I've got the perfect thing for you.
What's that?
This is beautiful. It's gonna give you so much energy.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Fine.
We'll be right back.
Hey guys, it's your boy, and welcome to some Did You Know facts about gaming. In 2011, there was an examination about text and subtitles in video games that helped improve student outcome in the general world than without paratext. Did you know, gaming also helps to learn general history of the world, like playing World War games, with context and with the correct facts and research to back up what they are showing us. In the Call of Duty World at War campaign, you are playing as an American Marine during the island hopping campaign of the Pacific Front. You are shown how difficult it was to actually get on the island and how many sacrifices they had to make to get on the island. And the Japanese were really ruthless in the Pacific Front, showing that they'll die for their country instead of surrendering to the enemy. In the Eastern Front of World War II, in the Battle of Stalingrad, you are shown the devastation of what has become the city, and also how the ruthless the Germans were, leaving no man surviving. As you lay amongst your comrades, you are trying your best to play dead before you become one of the victims of Stalingrad. Near the end of the war, the campaign shows you how brutal and ruthless the Russians were, just like the Germans were back to them in Stalingrad. It shows you what people are going through during the Battle of Berlin. They become the very thing they swore to destroy. Enough of the history lesson, let's get down to the present. In this article on the Guardian website, it states that video gaming can benefit mental health. I personally believe this is true because gaming has also helped me through some tough times during school, finals, GCSEs and all that stuff. It helps people.
Did you know that a quarter of the world's population have Facebook? And if you didn't quite understand that, that equals to the population of China, the US, and Brazil combined. Social media is a platform for the public around the world to discuss their issues and opinions. It's very hard to say that social media has not had an impact on many people's lives, and to say it hasn't would be a It has brought a lot of families together and have reunited long-lost friends. Here are a few interviews of some of the creators of the biggest social media apps, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram.
It's an online directory that connects people through universities and colleges through their social networks there.
We originally started with 140 characters so that we could fit in one text message, which is what the whole service was based on.
We created Instagram was to be able to share and communicate visually, something I care deeply about.
Thank you very much for watching. This is my Did You Know That a Quarter of the World's Population Have Facebook. Thank you very much.
Is that the time already?
You're late! Get to work, now!
I'm sorry, sir. I won't be any later than 30 minutes, I promise. I didn't realise the time got ahead of me yet. I'll be there as soon as I can. Yeah, sorry. Bye.
Late.
Fuck, the house is on fire. Where are you? Why aren't you here?
And that's all, folks.
And then it happens. That moment when your breath starts to slow. And every time you breathe out all the oxygen you have. Everything stops. Your heart, your lungs, and finally your brain. And everything you feel and wish and want to forget, it all just sinks. And then suddenly, you give it air again. Give it life again. I remember the first time it happened to me, I got so scared I wanted to call 911, go to the hospital and be kept alive with machines and apple juice. But I didn't want to look like an idiot. I didn't want to fuck up everyone's night. And then over time, that's all I wanted. Those 2 seconds of nothingness.
I love you in a place where there's no space or time.